next guest is Arrow's multitasking father, John Diggle. And New York City Mayor, Carter Poole on Blue Bloods. Please give a Phoenix Comicon Fan Fest welcome to the very talented and busy Mr. David Ramsey.
That was nice.
That was great.
Hey, everyone dancing? Excited about the Super Bowl coming here to, yeah. We'll be here in this building too, right? It's going to be great.
You're going to visit the 50-yard line?
Oh, yes. It's going to be awesome. I can't wait.
Okay,
hey,
so
Phoenix, what's happening?
So if anyone didn't see the midseason finale, you should not be here right now.
Yeah. Did everyone see it? Yeah! You thought we were gonna hold back, didn't you?
Nope. So that was a shocking episode. In all the episodes that you've had so far, for you, what has been the most shocking turn of events that you've had?
Most shocking? Phoenix, what's up?
It's your show.
All right, well, let's see. The most shocking turn of events? Mm-hmm. That's tough. There's been a lot of shockers. You know, Diggle I think Diggle saves Oliver's life every other episode. It's a requirement. But I won't be helping him in this one.
No.
That's a good question, isn't it? Well, you know, the Arrow hood is like the Batman cowl. Anyone can put it on.
Oh. Really?
Not quite really. But kind of. I mean, it's ultimately no, they have to finish the island. So, I mean, everyone knows everything's going to work out. But it's the first time I saw the mid-season finale was the same time you guys saw it. And I was just like, wow. Yeah. I mean, they just really, really went for it. I thought the fight would be more kind of involved a little bit. You know what I mean? Just like a little bit more involved. I mean, he really made Oliver look whack. I mean, it was just bad. It was like you know, it was varsity against the worst JV team ever. You know what I mean? But, and then he just didn't pull any punches. I mean, just right off a mountain. So, yeah, I mean, it was brutal. It was brutal, even for us. And I mean, after Steven was done, he was like, it's gonna be killer, Dave. It's gonna be killer, man. And I'm like, well, don't tell me anything. I wanna see it with everybody else. So it's great. I'm really glad they went for it.
I don't think you wanna hear me ask questions. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna try raising hands. And so when you ask a question, if you can stand up and speak very loudly. If we have problems, we do have a mic, but let's try the whole.
Yeah, be bold, be bold.
So right here, right in the front.
There we go.
I know that with Felicity's character, she wasn't necessarily supposed to be a really big part of the show.
Right.
And because of her, they developed it that way. When you went in an audition and was trying out, did you know Diggle was going to be this big and this much?
Yeah, you know, that's a very good question. Greg Berlanti, who created the show, saw me on a show called Blue Bloods, right? Woo! And yeah, Blue Bloods is great. It's Tom Selleck. I got a great Tom Selleck story too. I'll tell you guys about it later. So he saw me on the show, and they didn't want to pull the trigger. They didn't want to make me a regular yet. They had a lot of people on payroll and didn't want to make me a regular. So he was like, hey, you wanna come in and meet on this show we're doing, DC show called The Green Arrow? And I was like, yeah, whatever. And he said, well, listen, there's not much to do in the pilot, but he becomes a very integral part of the team, of the vigilante team. And it really was just kind of me and him and some other people. And he was like, he's gonna be the guy. And I was like, fine. But you know, the show really, really needed Felicity. And she was really a godsend, really, because, I mean, it was just me and Steven brooding every single week. It was just, I'm gonna go kill him. No, you can't. Life is more important than that, Oliver. You don't know what killing people does to the soul. So thank God for Felicity. She came and brought some light to the foundry. Otherwise, it just would have been, you know. And actually, I mean, to be honest with you, she's just in terms of her personality, her character is kind of more of a fit for the Flash, to be honest with you, just in terms of how they write. But she's needed more where she is on the Arrow. Thank God for her.
Okay, we have this gentleman over here. Over here. Yes.
Okay.
Hey.
Hey, David.
Hey.
Okay, I love you on Arrow 2. You do a really good John Ditto, especially for the pilot. For your other show, Blue Blood, how is it working with Tom Selleck?
It's great. Here's the Tom Selleck story. Here it goes. Now, for all you youngsters, you may not know that Tom Selleck used to be a huge television star. And he used to do this show in the 80s called Magnum P.I. And he was tremendous. He's still big, but he was tremendous, tremendously large back then. So people know him for that show, basically, Magnum. So now he shares the limelight a bit on the show with Donnie Wahlberg, and they both are fantastic on the show. So now on the show, let me give you a little backstory. I play the mayor of New York. This is not a small time character, right? He's the mayor of New York. He's a liberal mayor, young liberal guy coming in, and he's shaking things up. Tom Selleck plays the older, stalwart police commissioner. I'm his boss for all intents and purposes. So yeah, I know it's funny. So in this particular scene, now we're shooting in Harlem in this particular scene right now. The whole show is shot all throughout New York, mostly Brooklyn. We're shooting this particular scene in Harlem. Now, in the scene, I'm standing up in front of this brownstone, and I'm wearing my mayoral overcoat, and I have this big, long speech. And back at the time, Tom Selleck had back surgery before this. He was gingerly walking because his back was really hurting. So before each scene, he would only come out right at his part. He was supposed to be out there in the crowd, but he will come out only when he has a line. So he's not out yet. There's about 75 people, all mixed ethnicities. It looks like New York, right? So I'm talking, I'm doing my mayoral stuff, and they're like, yeah, some spattering of applause, some boos, you know, he's the mayor. Tom Selleck walks around the corner to come do his part. All of a sudden, I swear to God, 150 over 50 year old black women from every brownstone around runs out screaming, Magnum! Magnum! They're screaming, right? And I'm like, I'm the mayor of New York. And they're screaming. He signs every single one of their autographs. And it's awesome. And I'm like, wow, the mustache still does it for me. I can grow a mustache.
Yelling at
thank you very much. I'm like, Tom Selleck, you ain't got a six pack though, Blaine. You ain't got a six pack. Tom Selleck.
Sir, we had a hand right
there's
here.
There's your Selleck story.
There you go. That's yeah. A great Selleck story. Sir?
First of all, I just want to say, you know, congratulations on having a TV character become a comic book character.
Oh, yeah, that's awesome. And listen, that's really because of you guys. That's really, you guys wrote in and they listen, they really listen to social media. So, if you want Jon Stewart, let them know.
Well, I just wanted to ask, you know, now that Diggle's suddenly unemployed, is he going to work for Palmer?
That's funny. No. I'm not going to work for Palmer. But you know, it's interesting because just getting a little bit to that point, there's a lot of stuff that's going to come out because Oliver's going to be gone for a while, obviously. I mean, if you saw the finale,
for a while.
He's going to be gone for a while. And I mean, but you'll see him during the show because they have a very good storyline in terms of how what's going to happen and how he ultimately makes a return. And but during that time, Starling City will be under the protection of the fragmented Team Arrow and the upcoming Black Canary. And they aren't quite sure what they want to do yet with Adam, with the Atom in terms of, but you guys saw the exoskeleton already, right? You saw, wasn't that awesome? And so yeah, but there'll be a little, there's a lot of bonding. What's funny, I got a little story about this too. I got stories, I'm full of stories. And you know, when Steven left, because he left the Foundry, so we had to do like four or five or whatever episodes. It was me and Katie and Colin and Colton and Emily. And we're in the Foundry and we have, you know, and we're going out and fighting crime and we're by ourselves. So there was a real bonding period just with the four of us without Steven. So Steven now just recently came back. We're now shooting the episodes now, right? And you know, this isn't a secret, so he comes back. And what's funny is, there was a moment where me, Colton, and Emily are talking. And we've been doing what we've been doing for the past five episodes, which is cracking jokes and banter and just, ha ha ha, we're just having fun, blah, blah. And then Steven, bless his heart. Steven kind of said something to kind of get in on the conversation. You know what I mean? He's like, yeah, and blah, 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 right? And we all go, yeah, he's back. So it was just interesting, just kind of that void without him. You guys will feel it as you're watching. I mean, obviously you will still see Steven, but it's just the writers are very, very, very smart. It's very good writing on the show, and I think all of this starts with the writing. I mean, we do what we do as actors, but we can't do any of it without the writing. So my hats go off to them.
Yeah. You said, I'm sorry, I have one question. Yeah. You said Fragment and Team Arrow. Yeah. Is Diggle gonna get a suit?
I know, Diggle gets a, now that's interesting because I did, you know, he's gonna get something. I mean, Diggle can't really be out in the field. It's so funny. Because we'll be shooting something, right? And Steven will come clad in green leather, and he runs behind the warehouse with his bow and arrow, and he's like, yeah, we have to find the killers. And then Colton comes up behind them, clad in red leather, and he's like, yeah, we gotta find them, boss. And then I come up, right?
In a hoodie.
Right, nothing. I got a bomber jacket on, right? With a Glock, like, yeah! Let's kill somebody! They will know who I am, but let's kill them anyway. It's horrible. So, you know, I think there's some groundswell on Twitter, like, hashtag Diggle gets a mask. Yes. Anything, like, keep sending that stuff in. They love it, and they will answer it. So I talked to Greg, kind of, Berlanti again, kind of briefly about that. So, yeah, you'll be seeing something soon.
Great. Okay. Yes, please, I took your question. So, go ahead.
Yeah, you did.
I did, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Okay, a lot of the fans I've seen during the crossover episode, like, when Greg went up and ran up to you and went, oh my God, Diggle's reacting just like the fans, and that's the fandom right there, to how fast he is. Now, what was your thoughts of that scene, and have you bought a Fuck Cancer shirt?
Yeah, well, yes, I have bought the Fuck Cancer shirt. F Cancer shirt. Wonderful cause. Thank you all for supporting it. It's fantastic. Yes, your question, your first part of your question was, what was that first part of the question?
your reaction to the first scene of class.
Yeah, well that. Here's another story. Andrew Kreisberg, who was one of the executive producers and writers of The Flash and Arrow, he's really working very hard on The Flash right now because it's just getting off the ground. He was on set that day. They were shot that scene. And it's written that, you know, Diggle loses his cool. That's pretty much how it was written, when he sees the Flash and how quickly he moves. And so Andrew said, just go for it. I said, fine. And before they said action, I said, Andrew, how big can I go? And he said, exactly what he said. He said, it's the Flash. You can be as big as you want. What you saw when he goes like that was the third take, because like the first and second take, everybody lost it. I mean, everybody behind the camera, they just howled laughing. So it was a lot of fun. Anytime you get to see Diggle kind of have fun, it's kind of interesting, because Diggle is so, you know, so by the book, so kind of brooding a little bit. So it's always nice. And the second part of the episode, the second part of that crossover, our part, when he gets to propose to Lila, is very sweet. Anytime you get to see Diggle that way, kind of sweet and funny, it's always a nice treat, because he's so by the book and stalwart.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Good. Let's go back here. This gentleman back here. Yes.
Hey.
Okay.
Just after visiting you to booth and getting
a
picture, I feel like we're basically best friends.
So do I. Do I owe you any money?
I'm best friend to another. If you want to put in a word for me with Felicity.
Ah! I know. You know what's funny? We had there was a LA premiere of the crossover episode, and we had like a panel like this, and there were people that came up to the mics to ask questions, and they're like, the one dude came up and he was like, "Hey, Felicity," and she was like, "Yes," and or Emily, and she was like, "Yes," and he said, "Are you single?" And she was like, "Yes, I am," and this is exactly what he did. He was like, "Oh." Online, it's hilarious. He just walks away like she just told him, "Yes, I'm married," or something. Like, no. Can I put in a good word? No. But she'll see this on YouTube, so.
Over to this side.
Excuse me.
Hey.
I never really watched the show, but I'm just out of curiosity. Are you planning on having like Red Arrow being the show, or has he already? I don't really know.
Has Red Arrow appeared on the show?
Yeah.
Was that the question? Yes, Colton Haynes plays Red Arrow / Arsenal. Hilarious, and plays it very well. But like most characters on the show, Roy Harper isn't exactly the way he's written in the comic book. I think he's a heroin addict, or was, or something like that in the comic book. Not exactly a drug addict, though he was injected with a drug last season, Mirakuru, which is Japanese for makes you strong as hell. And but we got him cured from that. I'm just running down the whole show for you, and now he's just an expert. Kick butter, street fighter / archer. He's been trained by Oliver Queen. Oliver Queen, who's Arrow, who's the lead of the show, by the way. And there you go.
Thank you.
I know, you love that one.
All the way in the back, in the sweatshirt.
So, Bennett was over here in Phoenix Comicon. Someone was asking about the standing ladder. He pretty much said that you were sort of the champion of that. I was wondering if you could hear a comment.
That what he said? Yeah. Well, I'll pay Manute later on for saying that. You know, the salmon ladder, I don't know if I'm a champion. I don't know about that. What's interesting about this season is that I don't think anyone's the champion of the salmon ladder this season. I don't know. You guys can probably count on one hand how many times you've seen Steven and any of us with our shirts off this season. I really do. Really? I mean, it's a lot less this season, isn't it? No, baby girl, that's by design. Because that's hard. You know how hard it is to keep an 8-pack? Really, like a 6-pack, even a 4-pack. Do you know how hard that is? No, it's really difficult. So the salmon ladder, I don't know. I mean, I don't know if I'm champion of it. The salmon ladder, really, if you can do a pull-up, honestly, if you can do like maybe 2 or 3 pull-ups, you can do a salmon ladder. It's about technique. You got to swing, pull-up, swing, pull-up, swing. So, but, you know, we haven't been doing the whole shirt off a whole lot this season, because it's been a tiring season. But don't worry, season 4 is coming. Second half of season 3 is coming. We'll take it all. So hard to please you people.
Yes, right here.
Are you married? Yes, I'm married. Yes, I'm married.
Now yep. She's talking.
Yep.
Okay, over yep. here in the green shirt, lady, miss.
Did they actually say that online?
Yeah.
How do you guys get this stuff? There's a mole. There's a mole. Yes, yes, you'll see more of my than that. In the Super Max Argus situation. That's a very good storyline in terms of how we get more of Manu as well. And John Barrowman, wow. Don't you love him? He's the greatest ever. He keeps us laughing all the time. Yeah, you'll see John Barrowman. And John, what's interesting about John's character, Dark Archer slash Malcolm Merlyn, what's also about him, it's also awesome that John's kind of playing him this way, is that, you know, he has that Joker thing in the sense that he really feels as if he's doing the right thing. Like this, he's compelled to do this. And there's a righteous ending in his mind, right? He's doing this stuff for righteous reasons. So it's just great. But John is just, he just cracks us up on set. You know, it's amazing, first of all, that me and Steven get any work done at all, ever in life. Because we make fart noises and we're always cracking each other up and John Barrowman does not help. He takes it to a completely and totally new level. So when John Barrowman, me, Steven, and Colton are in the foundry, it's time to play. I mean, we just barely get any work done. And the blooper reel, I mean, this year's blooper reel, when you get the end of season 3 DVD, when that finally happens, I think it's gonna be probably as long as an hour, as an episode. We just, every other take is like, cut! All right, can we straighten up, guys? Can we straighten up? I don't know. We're just laughing all the time. It's crazy, it's awesome. You didn't ask that question, but I just thought I'd tell you that.
All right, let's go over here, the gentleman in the coat. There you go.
So how long until Sarah Diggle picks up
her
gun and joins the team?
Sarah, isn't she sweet?
She's adorable.
Well, you know what's interesting about that whole thing is that, you know, Diggle is Oliver 3 years later, right? He's already had his crucible. I always say that his Afghanistan was his crucible, you know, and Oliver has yet to fully adjust to his crucible, which was the island. So ultimately, that will be Oliver, right? Ultimately, hopefully, he will be who Diggle is, a guy who's okay with fighting crime and putting his life on the line and has a wife and a child. And that's ultimately, I mean, did you see the look on Oliver's face when he came to the hospital and baby Sarah was born and he was just like.
That was all Stephen's face.
I know, that was all Stephen's face, right? He was just like, I want that. You know, so ultimately that's where that character is going. And, you know, if everything works out, I guess it'll be with Felicity.
Let's go over to this side. This person back in the back. Pointing at you, right there.
Hey.
Hi, I enjoyed taking a picture with you, and I just want to say you're absolutely lovely in person.
Oh, thank you.
And I wanted to know how you feel playing a father. What's your take on that?
Well, it's interesting. My son is 4 years old, right? So it's still, fatherhood's still new for me. Steven has a wonderful 15-month-old, Mavi, who he's always, I think he's 15 months. And so how do I feel playing a father on television? It's great. I just think Diggle's a great role. Diggle says the stuff that you guys are thinking, I think, which we always try to do, you know what I mean? Like, this man runs 600 miles an hour. Like, what does that do when you look at that for the first time, right? So it's just, Diggle has the reaction, I think, that people that are watching the show has. And he's probably the most fully adjusted character on the show, you know, just in terms of, he has a family, he fights crime, he's well adjusted. And so he's a great character. He's just a great, great character. Even for television, I think he's just a great character. And what's great about him is that he doesn't have the cannon to lean back on, to say, you know, what I don't get a lot, unlike Steven and a lot of other characters, that this isn't in the new 52. because he's not in the New 52 or in any, you know, he's now in the Green Arrow universe, but he wasn't before, so there wasn't any canon to kind of rely on in the creation of Diggle. So it's just great to kind of make this together with the writers.
Yeah, great. This person down here in the Captain America shirt.
Hey, what's one of your favorite moments from behind the scenes with John Barrowman?
John Barrowman. Let me. I'm trying to get this scene because I know I have an answer for that. There was this moment where, and anybody who's on a film set, I mean, you guys, everyone knows how they shoot now. If me and you have this scene, right? The camera's behind you, over your shoulder, looking at me, so it sees a piece of you, but they don't see your face. They see me. So in this particular scene, it's me and Steven. You're John Barrowman, right? So you're giving us your lines, okay? And we have to act, right? But they don't see your face. Okay, so you got the picture. That's the way it is right now. So I'm on camera, Steven's right here, and John is looking at us, camera's behind him. So I don't know what the line is. John has to say something like, I don't know, I'm going to the store for milk. And I wasn't the line, but let's just say that's the line. This is John Barrowman. This is me and Steven are looking at John, and we're like, we're doing our brooding stuff, right? Because I'm Diggle, he's Oliver, and we're like, right? So John Barrowman says, I have to go to the store and get some milk. But this is what he does. He does. I have to go to the store and get some cheese. Oh, fuck, God damn it. And me and Steven have to stay, like, in the moment. So we're like this. John Barrowman is one of the funniest men I've ever worked with before in my life. And he doesn't help me and Steven at all. You know, on our coverage, he doesn't help. He just lets us have it. And, you know, so that's our John Barrowman story. He's a very, very funny, funny man.
Yeah, that's great.
Yeah.
Over here in the red shirt.
Hey, how's it going?
Hey.
I've got a question for Kate, the moderator.
Oh, jeez.
What's David Ramsey like? Is that guy pretty chill?
He's very chill. Yeah. He is a very, very nice man.
There you go. That's a good question.
Yeah. Ooh. Dodged it. Okay, down over here in the gray shirt.
You did well, yes. Kate. You did well.
Thank you. Thank you very much. This nice lady right here.
Steven said that he would do American Ninja if I told him if they would let him. Yeah. Would you do that as well?
Yeah, you know, I would do American Ninja, but I have to probably shed a few pounds because American Ninja, it works when you don't have as much muscle on, I think. I mean, not that I'm that muscular at all. I'm just saying. I would train for it. I mean, obviously I would train for it. But yes, I would do it. I love American Ninja. I would do it.
Great.
Yeah, in a heartbeat. Absolutely.
You and Steven could do it, Tag.
We could do it. Yeah, yeah. Steven's very competitive. I love Steven. He's incredibly, incredibly competitive. There's a scene where me, him, and Katie Lotz have we're practically naked in a scene last season. And we're fighting with bamboo sticks, right? And staffs. And and I take off my shirt and take off my pants, and Katie Lotz is like, oh my God, David, look at your calves, right? And Steve is like, put on some pants, David. I'm like, yeah, don't be mad, because mine's bigger than yours.
He's always posting about don't skip leg day.
Yeah, exactly. We always say that. We're always like, don't skip leg day. Don't skip leg day.
All right. This person right over here.
Hey.
So you've already done a few imitations of some of the cast members and Jess, I'm sure. Can you go to each cast member and imitate them?
Yeah. All right. Here we go. Beginning with, let's see. Colton Haynes. Now let's give ourselves a line. The line will be, I have to go to the store and get some milk. I mean, that's what we've been doing. We've been doing that all night, so let's stick with that. So Colton Haynes, I have to go to the store and get some milk. Here's Colton Haynes. I have to go to the store and get some milk. It's intense. Okay, and here's Oliver. This is important. This is an important moment. Watch the hand. This is Oliver Queen doing it. I have to go to the store and get some milk. Really, this might not seem like a lot, but watch. Every time you look at Steven, he's doing something with his hands down there. And I said, Steven, why do you do that with your hands? It's like a nervous twitch or something. You know what he said? Now, this is what I think, honestly. I think it is a nervous twitch. I don't think it's any acting thing at all. He tried to spin it like, no, David, I'm a really, really trained actor. So it's something that I brought to Oliver Queen. He said, well, you know, David, archers do this thing with their fingers. So, you know, they have this thing because they're always doing this, right? So they're always doing this. So I have this thing that I do on my finger. And I'm like, boy, you know you just have some nervous twitch. So that's Steven. All right, so, and then there's Emily. Emily Brett. So there's Felicity doing, I have to go to the store and get some milk. And she hears this. I have to go to the store and, like, get some milk. That's her. And then there's Katie Cassidy. It's Katie Cassidy doing, I have to go to the store and get some milk. I have to go to the store and get some milk. No movement. And then there's finally David Ramsey. Paul Blackthorne? Yeah, hold on. You know, he's doing an American accent. Well, you don't believe it? It's not a good American accent? It's pretty good, right? You didn't? What do you think he was on the show? On the show?
Yeah, until I saw an interview with him and he was speaking in British.
Yeah. Yes, speaking in British, that's true. Where do you find these people, Katie? Where do you find them?
They're all here.
Well, you know, we want to be careful not to speak in British. So it's, let's see, Paul Blackthorne. I think I'm starting to get some milk. Would be, I have to go to the store and get some milk. He doesn't have any hair, get it this way. And then finally, there's David Ramsey, I have to go to the store and get some milk. As Diggle. Oliver, we have to go to the store and get some milk. That was exhausting.
That was inside the actor's studio. Okay.
That was ridiculous.
This gentleman with the camera.
Are there any characters, heroes or villains that you would like to see brought into the series?
Yes, I would love to see Bruce Wayne. I don't know if I want to see Batman, but I would love to see Bruce Wayne. And it's two billionaires, two guys trained. I would just love to see where he fit. I would love to see maybe even Bruce Wayne, like when we have this whole, the League of Assassins is gonna be a big kind of story in the second part of the season. I don't know everything about that, but it'd be great to see that Bruce Wayne at that time is part of the League. You know what I mean? Like, he's part of the League at that time, to find out where in the timeline he fits. I mean, that would be awesome to me. You know what I mean? Like, he's like, looks at Oliver like, yeah, like, you know, I don't know if I like Ra's al Ghul either. This is kind of crazy. You know, who are you? I mean, because in the comic book, Oliver Queen's the older stalwart, right? He's older than Bruce. So the writers have gone on record and said that, you know, there are two cities that may not be mentioned very much, if ever, on the show, and that's Gotham and Metropolis. So, which is, you know, it is what it is. But I will, me personally, as a fan, mention Metropolis, mention Gotham. I mean, it's like the two biggest cities in DC, right? So, but you know, the stuff with DC, I mean, every time they have to get permission for every single thing they do, and thank God we do have a lot of characters we can play with. But as a fan, yes, I would love to see Bruce Wayne. Right. That's right. There is. So it's, and So we'll see. I don't know if it was in the original, in this, there was some mention of a pilot or something going on in Flash, and there's some kind of hint about Hal Jordan or something like that, some type of pilot stuff. So, I mean, we'll see. But, you know, it's funny because we just, you would think we have access to all the characters. Even Harley Quinn, right? You only saw in the Suicide Squad kind of part of her shoulder and part of her back, and you heard her voice. And I think maybe, you may not have seen that much of her, but you heard her voice.
Yeah.
And that's because, you know, they're kind of saving her for Suicide Squad, and there you go. The Suicide Squad, the movie, yeah.
Yep.
Hey, David.
Hey.
I have a quick question. Do you ever, like, as Diggle gets so mad at Ollie, he just doesn't get that anybody in his family could be guilty? It's kind of irritating.
Yeah.
Because he's like, Thea didn't do that. She wouldn't do that.
Right.
What the heck are you talking about?
Right.
Do you ever, like, just want to go, listen up, buddy?
Yes. Yes. In answer to your question, yes. I think Diggle always wants to do that to Oliver, right? I think Diggle's the guy sometimes who's like, I can't believe I'm risking my life for this kid. Sometimes I think he actually does think that way. But and we're going to get into this a little later, but also some of Diggle's, like, why he's so stuck on Oliver, like, why he fell in love with this kid. I think that he's the brother that he couldn't save, Andy. And we'll get into this Andy Diggle's with Deadshot and Hive and Suicide Squad on the second part of the season, into season four. That Andy was the brother he couldn't save, and Oliver is the brother he can save. And that's really the attachment. That's really the attachment that he has to Oliver. He's the brother he can save.
Mm-hmm. And the striped shirt over here?
Yeah. Big. There's a big Suicide Squad episode coming out, at least one, maybe even two, this upcoming second half of the season. And then Hive, the fourth season. So, yeah, there's some Suicide Squad stuff coming. We're not done. Deadshot, Michael Rowe did such a great job with Deadshot. And the relationship between him and Diggle, which, again, like Felicity, no one really expected that to kind of morph into what it became. So, so yes, you'll be seeing a lot more of Suicide Squad. But there's also the movie coming out, so you know there's only so much I think that we can do with it.
Okay, so right there.
Wanted to ask a quick question about what it was like to work on Dexter, mm-hmm. and if you have any stories about pranks that you may have been a victim of or played on cast members of Arrow, Dexter, or anything else you've worked on.
Yeah, well, let's see. Dexter was incredible. Michael C. Hall is probably one of the best actors ever in life. And what was funny about that, though, is that, yes, I do have a story. The first day on set, I'm in bed with Deborah Morgan, right? We're in bed together. And this is also the first day I meet Michael C. Hall. And this is right before he and Jennifer get married at the time. And so this is literally it. It's like, there's Video Village where the director and producers and whatnot, they sit behind the monitors watching what's being shot. That's called Video Village. And so when I come in, Jennifer's already kind of there, kind of waiting, and I've met her before. And Michael is kind of near Video Village, and I'm like, hey, how you doing? Big fan, blah, blah, blah. He's like, welcome to the show, great. So he goes behind Video Village, and then I get into bed with his to-be wife, girlfriend at the time, and it's just like, I kind of see him out of the corner of my eye looking at the monitor like, and I gotta like smooch with his girlfriend. So it was a little awkward in that respect, but it turned out great. It was a great role and just a great time. I'm not quite sure how happy I was with the finale. But then again, what do you do? What do you do? What do you do with that guy? You either kill him, you put him in jail. I mean, what do you do? So I don't know. It was just tough to end that. I think that was a show that was tough to end and make everyone happy. Period. Because what do you do? And so if you want to see Dexter again, you keep him alive, and his dark passenger will always be with him, and it excludes everyone else in his life. So I applaud that choice. It was a daring choice, but obviously it didn't make everyone happy.
My question is, Oliver Queen seemed to have a pity party all the time.
Yeah.
Like everything's always
You know, everything.
I know. Wow, wow, wow. Oh, me, the island. Oh. Yeah, I know.
I find it hard to watch sometimes, but yeah. What would you do as your character to make him happy? What would make Oliver Queen happy so he would be so sad?
So sad. Well, I think for Diggle, he would be like, get with Felicity, homie. I think for Oliver, I mean, for Diggle, I think Diggle is like, yes. Diggle's always been about you have to get your humanity, right? You can't go around killing people, Oliver. It scrapes a part of your soul off. Get with Felicity because you love her. But I think the thing about Felicity, I think the reason why he wants them together is because Diggle has always tried to push Oliver into being more in touch with his humanity. And he is truly, honestly in love with Felicity. So I think, unlike the other 578 women that he slept with in Star Wars. I always laugh about that, because I'm like, Felicity, I know you love Oliver, but didn't you see all these women he slept with? Anyway, that would be me being Diggle. But Diggle, I think Diggle, in terms of what he would want to make Oliver happy, I think he would want Oliver to embrace his humanity, and I think a big part of that would be embracing the relationship that he could potentially have with Felicity. Yeah.
There's a hand up here with a black shirt on. Right, yep.
That is a very good question and very softly asked. She asked, do I think that Thea will join Team Arrow now that she's been trained by her daddy? There's a big storyline coming for Thea. I mean, you guys are about to flip out on in terms of what's going on with Thea and, you know, Daddy Merlin. And so I can only say in answer to your question, I can't really answer that. This is a really good question. I can't really answer that, but stay tuned for the revelation of what's going on with Thea and her daddy. It's gonna be big.
This gentleman who is Groot in the shirt. Are you? Really? Okay, there you are.
Quick question.
Yep.
Is Arsenal going to lose his arm in any time in the show? Yeah. Is John Diggle going to be John Stewart?
Yeah, that's two good questions. As far as I know, he doesn't lose his arm. As far as I know, but maybe he does. That's a great producer question. And then, you know, and stuff changes. Like the stuff they start off. The writers really start off with big themes, and things kind of get filled in within those themes, and that's really a more of a writer, producer question. I don't think that he loses an arm, but maybe he will. Am I John Stewart? I don't know, man. That's what I'm saying. Write in, tell him, yes, John Diggle's John Stewart, and then maybe it'll happen, who knows? But as far as right now, and listen, they've gone at great lengths to really, like, dig John Diggle into the lexicon, and I don't know if they're ready to give that up yet, but who knows? I know, I want the power ring too, man. But you know what, then it becomes a different show, right? Because it's gonna be like, we're a crew of soldiers, whatever. Like, just construct a brick wall. Get through that, Miracruz. So, maybe, who knows? You know, but I can tell you this, and because it's they've said this publicly, they do want to kind of do the crossover thing, that they want that to be a thing. You know what I mean? They want to do that more often. It was really, really successful. And so if he is John Stewart, he can perhaps exist in that universe, because that universe does exist over in Central City.
Okay.
Hello. That's a great one. Yeah, because there in the crossover, you know what that was all about. Yeah, that was baby daddy or baby mama, right? She was there. Connor Hawk, another producer question. But I would imagine somewhere in the run of this show,
Connor Hawke has to show up someplace. He would have to, I would think. And what the producers tend to do is kind of ladies' eggs, and they're not hatched for like 6 months or, you know, 12 episodes down the line. So they put that there for a reason. I would think that Connor Hawke, there's a future to Connor Hawke someplace. I'm not quite sure what yet, because that's really their department. But I would think so.
Let's go all the way in the back to the gentleman in the black shirt. There you go.
Yes. Well, I appreciate you listening back there. No. Yes, more crossovers will be seen. Yes. I don't know when. You know, just logistically, it was a bit of a. I wouldn't say a nightmare, but it was just there were some challenges logistically, just in terms of scheduling, because we really were kind of shooting two shows at one time, which is kind of, it's just tough to do that. And but they're working the kinks out. And they've said publicly that I've been told that, you know, they want to do more of these crossovers. It was big. It was big news. It was the fans. You guys loved it, so it was great. They're going to do more of it. Yeah.
Good. Let's go over here to this person in the red shirt.
So, obviously, you're saying they want to do more crossovers, so yeah. Like that. And of course, the Justice League movie is going to be coming up. What if, like, are they thinking about doing maybe like a Justice League TV show, like a live action one?
Wouldn't that be great? Well, see, that's the thing, right? You guys tell them you want Jon Stewart. They make a Jon Stewart show. Boom. Flash is successful. Boom. Green Arrow is successful. Boom. They spin off and make a Birds of Prey. Who knows? Justice League. Hello. So I don't know. I mean, I don't know exactly what they're thinking, precisely what they're thinking, but Supergirl is possibly going to be happening. Another Greg Berlanti show. And I would think, you know, I don't know if they said this publicly or not, but I would think that if everything is happy and everyone's successful, that they cross over all this stuff. So will they do a Justice League television show? I don't know. But I can tell you this, if you have these franchises that are successful and the crossovers work, I can't see any reason why they wouldn't.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Let's go.
Oh. I know. Young Teen Titans, or they're talking about, what's, I'm trying to think of, Nightwing, yeah, there, all that stuff was, I don't know. I mean, it's amazing that anything gets made, because there's so much bureaucracy and red tape. But it's fantastic, it's wonderful, but it's just, the stuff you hear, it may never, ever come to fruition, or it might happen in a month. You know, you just never know.
There's someone all the way in the back.
Yep. Hey. Yeah, Sin. Yeah, she's. You'll see more of Sin, because Sin is going to have a very specific reaction to the person who is not Canary, but looks like Canary, but not Canary. And so, yeah, she will have some very specific things to say about that. So yeah, she'll be back for sure. Sin will be back.
Let's come over here. We're kind of neglecting this side over here. This person. Over here, you, yes.
So, yep. You mentioned about Supergirl.
Yeah.
What do you think John Diggle's reaction would be on meeting her?
Supergirl, right? If you think fries flew in the air. I don't know. I don't know what he would react to seeing. It depends on the outfit. Is it the Supergirl in the skirt outfit? Or is it like the new Supergirl? I don't know. That's a great question. I don't know what John Diggle's reaction would be. I know he would just flip out. I know that. He'll flip out for sure.
Okay, how about in the front row with the goggles on your head?
Yep.
Wouldn't that be awesome? I think that's, you know, they listen to you. You think you guys don't really, and maybe you do, maybe you don't, I don't know, but you guys really do have a lot of power. Give yourselves a hand. No, really. Right in. Right. They listen, tweet, all that stuff. Social media is very powerful. And let them know what you think, because they really do listen to you. The chemistry between Oliver and Felicity is really, really incredible. Is you know, you can cut it on screen. But you guys have a lot to do with that. You know, you guys, not the chemistry, but you guys have a lot to do with what you want to see happen in that relationship. And why they're writing to that. Greg Berlanti actually said that at Comicon, that you guys have a lot to do with that. So that is a great suggestion. Write in, tell them, let them know.
Somebody who hasn't asked a question. You haven't asked a question. Go ahead.
Hey.
Two kind of somewhat questions.
Yeah.
One, was there any crazy, insane, physical part of the show? And two, have somebody created a crazy prank on you that you felt, or have you played a crazy prank on somebody else?
What was physically the hardest on the show, physically, was probably my Suicide Squad episode. Was just me just having an episode by myself, and then there was another one when doing some stuff in Afghanistan. The episode where he had the flashback stuff again. That was probably the physically the hardest. I lost my voice. I remember Steven actually coming back to set, and he was like, "So how's it feel to be the star of the episode?" And I was like, "I do not envy you at all." So that was tough. And pranks, you know, something, we're so stupid on the show that we don't even play pranks. We just make dumb sounds. I mean, we just do stupid. We just do. This is me and Steve. This is me and Steve. I'll be on the set, and just we'll be there, and it'll be quiet, and I'll go Terminator 2, T2, right? That's what it is. We just do stupid stuff like that. We just make dumb sounds. For all you guys who don't know what that is, that's like the major thing, major sound. See, told you it was stupid. I told you it was stupid. But that's how dumb we are on set. Like, that's actually funny on set. That's how boring it is on set. That's funny.
All right.
It didn't work with this crowd because you're really tough and jaded, but it works in the foundry.
You didn't have the cadence just right for that crowd. I guess.
You have failed this city.
Yeah, thank you. Now that's comedy.
This gentleman down here in the...
Yeah, I know, right?
Yeah.
You know, Steven thought I was a guest star. It's the truth. Steven didn't know I was a regular. And it was funny. First time I met Steven, this is exactly what Steven said. Steven did this. You're like, "You're tall." I'm like, "Yeah, how you doing?" Good. And it, you know, the pilot was so stressful, really, because nothing like Arrow had been done. You know what I mean? Like, they were really kind of going off of the energy of the Dark Knight series and what Nolan had kind of done in the movies and that brooding dark thing. And we really had to get over the Smallville hype, or the Smallville hump, really. Because, you know, people were comparing the show to Smallville. And Smallville was a completely different show, completely different tone, everything. And we were going for something that really hadn't been done on television, at least not that in that way with the combo character. And Steven was under a lot of pressure. I mean, even you know, he handled it incredibly, to his great credit, but there was a lot of pressure on him, you know, and everyone kind of felt it, and so it immediately there was just kind of, he was in complete and total just Oliver mode. He was finding the guy, right, and he was shredded. I mean, like, when you see like season one Stephen Amell, it's just like, "Man, did you eat at all?" Like, he just lived at the gym. He just and even though now he's still shredded, but just then, just visually, he was just like just dieseled. And so between that and just kind of politically what he had to deal with, there wasn't really a whole lot of stuff going on with him and other people. But as soon as the season started, there was a bit of just a certain amount of relaxation because we're on the air. And immediately we just jumped into it. This is, Steven tells a story. I don't know if he says it publicly or not. But this is what won Steven over to me. And it wasn't really a winning over, because there was never a contentious relationship ever at all between me and Steven. Knock on wood. And it was fantastic. But there was a scene where he's in the Queen Mansion, and he's sitting down, and there's some other people in front of him. I'm playing John Diggle, the bodyguard at that time, slash chauffeur, slash black driver. And the camera's on him, so it's his close-up. So all I have to do is walk in frame, say something to him, and leave. That's all I have to do. Now, what I'm supposed to say is, Mr. Queen, your car is ready. Right, that's what I'm supposed to say. But instead, I go to his ear, and I say, Mr. Queen, I have very large, hairy blank. And Steven is just like, and from that day forward, you can tweet him, ask him, he'll tell you it's the absolute truth. From that day forward, it's been nothing but the most beautiful, wonderful relationship between me and Steven.
Okay, right up front.
Oh, so
Steven,
I have a question.
Well, I really like Captain Lance's character. I think that he doesn't get to do as much as I think. He's just a great actor. Paul Blackman's a great actor, but he's just a really good actor. I think that character can become something where you just go, okay, already, you know what I mean? But he just plays it so well. I think I would want to be him because he just has so much range, right? He's heartbroken. He was a guy who was chasing the vigilante. Now he's teamed up with the vigilante. He lost his daughter. He wants to marry the wife that he lost. I mean, just a lot of grit that character has, you know? And so if I played anything, I probably want to do Captain Lance because you can sink, as an actor, you can sink your teeth into that character.
Okay, we have about 5 minutes, so we have time for just a few more questions. So do we have, over there, okay, he says go over there. Which arm?
I haven't seen anybody over there.
Which arm?
Any arm.
Okay, the one with the black sleeve.
What was the audition process like?
Or?
The audition process. Well, it was fortunate for me because I went into what is called, as an actor, a friendly room. And a friendly room, an unfriendly room, is a room like this one. This is a friendly room. This is wonderful. No, an unfriendly room is a room where an actor walks in and there's a producer or director and they don't really know who you are and you're really coming in and showing them, like, no, you need to know me, right? So you have to make believers out of them. A friendly room is a room where you really have the role and they want you to be there, and this is really a formality that you have to kind of go in and meet the people, and they know all your work, they made calls already, you're one of two other people that they're considering, and they want you to be incredible. So that's a friendly room. So when I walked in, I met with our director and Andrew Kreisberg, and they were basically like, you know who this guy is, and let's see what you got. And we did it, and, you know, I think a week later, that was it. So it was, because Greg Berlanti kind of wanted me for the role, that meant a whole lot. So it wasn't a very difficult process for me at all. But for someone like Emily went up against whoever she went up against, and for a guest star role, she was a local hire, Vancouver local hire, and she made believers out of everyone. And and thus, Felicity was born, you know? Yeah.
All right, last question. There was somebody, there you are, the young man with the, there you go.
Yeah, that's a good question as well. Will we see the Adam in full costume this season? And that's really a producer question. They're toying with that. I will say this, though, that by the end of the season, there will be at least three legitimate heroes that can protect Starling City besides Oliver Queen. So you'll see they're really building that up, that the city can live outside of Oliver Queen. That's a big part of the second season, second part of the season.
Okay, We are excited. Can't wait for that.
Yeah.
Next part. Thank you.
Thank you guys. You guys are fantastic.